Penguin Random House Audio presents Extreme Prey by John Sandford, read for you by Richard Ferrone. Chapter 1. Bright-eyed Marlis Purdy carried a steel bucket around to the side of the garage to the rabbit hutches, which were stacked up on top of each other like Manhattan walk-ups. She paused there for a moment, considering the possibilities. A dozen New Zealand whites peered through the screened windows, their pink noses twitching and pale eyes watching the intruder, their long ears turning like radar dishes, trying to parse their immediate future. Was this dinner or death? A car went by on the gravel road, on the far side of a ditch line of lavender yarrow and clumps of black-eyed Susans and purple coneflowers, throwing a cloud of dust into the late afternoon sun. Marlis turned to look. Laurie Schaefer, who lived 3 more miles out, didn't bother to wave. Marlis was a sturdy woman in her 50s, white curls clinging to her scalp like vanilla frosting. She wore rimless glasses, a homemade red-checked gingham dress, and low-topped Nikes. Short-nosed and pale, she had a small pink mouth that habitually pursed in thought or disapproval. She popped the door on one of the hutches and pulled the rabbit out by its hind feet. The animal smelled of rabbit food and rabbit poop and the pine shavings used as bedding. A 12-inch Craftsman crescent wrench, its working end rusted shut, lay on top of the hutches. Marlis stretched the rabbit over her thigh and held it tight until it stopped wriggling, then picked up the crescent wrench and whacked the rabbit on the back of the head, separating the skull from the spine. So it was death. The rabbit went limp, but a few seconds later began twitching as its nerves fired against oxygen starvation. That went on for a bit, and then the rabbit went quiet again. Some years before, Marlis had mounted a plank on the side of the garage at head height. Before mounting the board, she'd driven 2 20-penny common nails through it so that an inch of nail protruded, angling upward. Every year or so, she'd use a bastard file to sharpen up the nails. Now she positioned the bucket, with a used plastic shopping bag on the inside, under the board with the nails. She pushed the dead rabbit's feet onto the nails until the nails stuck through and, in a minute or so, had stripped the rabbit's fur, pulled off its head, and gutted it, all the unwanted parts and most of the blood draining into the plastic bag in the bucket. Not all of the blood. A dinner plate-sized blotch of old black blood stains marred the wooden side of the garage, supplemented by new red blotches from this last butchery. She carried the bloody meat back to the house, paused to tie up the top of the plastic bag and drop it into the garbage can, and, in the kitchen, washed the meat. During the entire 5-minute process of killing and butchering the rabbit, she'd never once thought about either the animal or the process. All of that was automatic, like pulling beets or picking wax beans. Marlis's brain was consumed with other thoughts of murder. If and when, and where and how, and with what? Marlis was a woman of ordinary appearance, if seen in a supermarket or a library, dressed in homemade or Walmart dresses or slacks, a little too heavy but fighting it, white-haired, ruddy-faced. In her heart, though, she housed a rage that knew no bounds. The rage fully possessed her at times, and she might be seen sitting in her truck at a stoplight, pounding the steering wheel with the palms of her hands, or walking through the noodle aisle at the supermarket with a teeth-baring snarl. She had frightened strangers who might look at her and catch the flames of rage, quickly extinguished when Marlis realized she was being watched. The rage was social and political and occasionally personal, based on her hatred of obvious injustice, the crushing of the small and helpless by the steel wheels of American plutocracy. Jesse walked into the kitchen, running a hand over his close-cropped hair. He peered over her shoulder into the sink. What are we having? Rabbit fettuccine Alfredo, Marlis said to her blue-eyed son. We're eating early, because I gotta get over to Mount Pleasant. You go on out and get me some broccoli and a tomato. Where's your brother? Messing around with that 22, Jesse said. He put a hand to his left cheek, a gesture of thought, a weariness in others, but in Jesse, an unconscious move to cover the port wine stain that marked his neck and the bottom of his cheek. He says there's nothing wrong with it that a good cleaning won't fix. Well, he knows his guns. Go get me that broccoli. We'll eat in an hour. Marlis and her younger son, Cole, lived on a 9-acre place north of Pella, Iowa, in a weathered, clabbered farmhouse with 3 bedrooms and a bathroom up, a living room, parlor, half-bath and kitchen down, and a rock-walled basement under all of that. The basement held the mechanical equipment for the house and a 21-cubic-foot whirlpool freezer that Marlis filled with corn, green and wax beans, peas, carrots, cauliflower, and broccoli, which kept them eating all winter. Applesauce from a half-dozen apple trees went in ball jars stored on dusty wooden shelves next to the freezer. Her older son, Jesse, until recently, had lived in an apartment in town with his wife and daughter and sold Purdy produce at most of the big farmers' markets between Cedar Rapids and Des Moines. Cole worked in the truck gardens and ran the mower at the country club during golf season. The two sons would jacklight 4 to 6 deer during the various hunting seasons, and the venison steaks and sausage, supplemented by the rabbits, filled out their meat requirements. They'd once had a chicken yard, but a midwinter spate of accounting several years earlier had convinced Marlis that chickens were cheaper to buy at the supermarket than to raise at home, even given the bonus eggs. In the winter, to raise cash, Marlis made hand-stitched quilts that she sold through an Amish store in Des Moines. She wasn't Amish, but nobody much cared as long as the quilts moved. The Purdys weren't rich, but they did all right, not counting the possibly inherited tendency to psychosis. Jesse walked down to the closest garden, cut a few broccoli heads. They were big and tough, being the last harvest of the first season, but good enough when chopped, and got a nice ripe tomato. All of that took only a minute, but by the time he started back to the house, he was sweating. There'd been a lot of rain that spring, and everything was looking lush and fine. At the moment, the sun was shining and the temperature was in the low 90s, with the humidity close to 80%. The local farmers, of course, were bitching because the bean and corn harvests were going to be huge and the prices depressed. Of course, if it hadn't rained, they'd be bitching because their crops were small, even if the prices were high. You couldn't win with farmers. For Marlis and her sons, the frequent rain was nothing but a blessing. More food than they could eat, so many apples that they'd have to cull them before they were mature to keep the apple tree branches from breaking. Enough raspberries and Concord grapes to make jam for 5 years of toast. Marlis had been talking of buying an upright freezer for the kitchen. She could freeze a year's worth of cinnamon apple slices, and they all did like apple pie. As Jesse walked back to the house, he noticed a pale haziness on the western horizon above the afterglow left by the sun, hinting of a new weather system moving in, even more rain. All right with him. Looking up at the top floor of the house, he saw Cole sitting behind the bedroom window screen with his rifle, which he had reassembled. You don't go shooting nobody, he called up to his brother. Cole didn't say anything, but lifted a hand. Gray-eyed Cole sat in his bedroom window looking out over the road, a scoped Ruger 10/22 in his hands. Squirrel rifle. Below him, a quilt hung on the wire clothesline airing out. Before the end of the day, the quilt would smell like early summer fields with a little gravel dust mixed in. A wonderful smell. A smell like home. An aging green pickup was motoring over the hill to the south, about to take the curve in front of the house.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.